Good morning, everyone. If you are returning, thanks again for joining us for Dr. Kamosi's second lecture. And if you're here for the first time, welcome. Here at Franciscan Missionaries of Our Lady University, we are at the tail end of our Franciscan Week celebration. And so I'd like to start with another prayer that comes from Francis himself. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Most High, glorious God, enlighten the darkness of my heart. Give me right faith, sure hope, and perfect charity. Sense and understanding, Lord, that I may carry out your holy and true command. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Once again, welcome. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Brian Pedraza, and I'm an associate professor of theology here at FRANU, and I want to welcome you on behalf of Dr. Redfield and Mrs. Carol Ann Bryan, who are sponsoring this lecture, and also on behalf of my colleagues in theology, Dr. David Whitten and Dr. Shane Owens. Our bioethics lecture series is a joint effort between our theology program and a new initiative of the university that we call REACH, which stands for Reflecting on Ethics in Catholic Healthcare. As the name suggests, we want to integrate Catholic Christian ethics into our formation of healthcare professionals. And it's our hope that a FRANU graduate would be exceptional, not only in the practical skills necessary to be a health professional, but also in the integral human formation needed to discern truth, goodness, and beauty from their counterfeits. A few notes before reintroducing our distinguished speaker. I'd like to first thank Dr. Valerie Schluter, Director of REACH, and Ms. Tammy Vadrine for their help in organizing and thinking through this event. A word of thanks also goes to Shelley Frederick and Rosie Kuiper and everyone at Our Lady of the Lake Hospital's continuing ed departments. By their efforts, those of you who are physicians or nurses can earn CMEs or CEUs by attending this morning. At the end of the lecture and before the Q&A, I'll post a link to a very short survey, something that can be accomplished in the neighborhood of 2 to 5 minutes. And those seeking continuing ed credits need to attend the lecture and then fill out the survey, and a certificate will be emailed to you. We'd also like to stress that it's our hope that everyone attending this morning would fill out the survey. To carry out the work of integrating ethics into our programs, we need the data to tell us how we're doing. And so when I post the link later, I ask that you please consider just taking a few minutes to fill it out. It's easiest if it's done immediately, but we'll also make it available for about a week. Since I mentioned the Q&A, just note that near the bottom of your screen, there should be an icon for Q&A. And if you have a question, feel free to type it there. You can do this at any point during the lecture. You don't have to wait to the end. And then when Dr. Kamosi is finished, I will collate those questions and present them to him as best as I can. Finally, neither FRANU nor Dr. Kamosi has any conflict of interest to declare in relation to this event. Okay, now, on for the main event. Fresh off of last night's stimulating lecture on throwaway culture, Dr. Charles Kamosi joins us this morning from the New York, New Jersey area, home of large thin slices of pizza and good bagels, where he is an associate professor of theology at Fordham. He's well published, not only in scholarly journals, of which he's published in many, but also in popular publications such as the New York Times, Washington Post, and LA Times. He advises the Faith Outreach Office of the Humane Society of the United States, the Pro-Life Commission of the Archdiocese of New York, and the American Solidarity Party. I imagine he would also say that his greatest achievement is the family he started with his wife, Pauline, or perhaps it's Paulin, which includes 4 children, 3 of whom they adopted from a Filipino orphanage in 2016. This morning's lecture is drawn from his newest book, Losing Our Dignity: How Secularized Medicine is Undermining Fundamental Human Equality. And so without further ado, I present to you Dr. Charlie Kamosi.
Hey, Brian, thanks for that introduction. I just want to say for the record that as a Midwesterner near Milwaukee and Chicago, I don't really consider what they call pizza out here pizza. It's a little too floppy. I need something with more substance. I joke that these are really rolled cheese burritos out here. I'm going to share my screen just to make sure this works while you're still here.
Okay.
Here, quote unquote. Let's see. share sound, optimize video. How did that do?
Looks great.
Okay. So, I'm really, as I mentioned last night, disappointed that I'm not there with you in person today. I didn't have slides yesterday throughout the whole presentation. Today, I will be speaking mostly from slides. I hope that's all right. There are a number of images and even videos that I think are going to be important for what I want to get across today. And from the title of the slide in front of you now, you know what I'll be talking about. Here's my basic thesis for today's presentation. Our secularized and even irreligious culture, especially in medicine and other institutions with incredible power, particularly over life and death, obviously, no longer has the resources to explain why all human beings are equal. Once we abandon the theological idea that all members of the human family are equal because they share a common nature, which bears the image and likeness of God, there was nothing left but actualized concepts like autonomy, rationality, self-awareness, will, and productivity in which to understand and locate moral value. Human beings quite clearly do not have these capacities in equal measure. Some appear not to have them at all. And more populations are falling out of the circle of protection that fundamental human equality provides. It's time to sound the alarm about where this is going. Now, I have to say, I am not an alarmist by nature. In fact, I really try to dial down the kind of alarmism that sometimes pervades many issues related to bioethics. But if this thesis is correct, I think there is a good reason to be an alarmist about it. I want to start with in making my case for this thesis, I want to start with a gravestone here. This is the gravestone for Terry Schiavo, who people of a certain age will no doubt remember as a major news story. And especially the first of the last few years before she died in 2005. I won't go through the whole story here, not least because it's very long and many of you already know it, but here's an important part. So this gravestone was actually created, the words and design were created by her husband, Terry Schiavo's husband, Michael Schiavo, who in my view is not a very good player in all of this. He was fighting to make sure that she was refused food and water. And again, I won't get into the story necessarily, but here's what's important here. He decided to describe her situation like this when she had her brain injury, which caused folks to describe her as being in a so-called permanent vegetative state or persistent vegetative state. It says that she departed this earth in 1990 when she had that brain injury, and she was at peace in 2005, a little bit more than 15 years later. There was a big, huge debate about what was Terry Schiavo. Was she alive? Was she dead? Was she not there? I think, could you remove the food and water for her? But this gravestone is making a particular claim that she departed this earth on February 25th, 1990. Here is Terry Schiavo in 2002 listening to music. And I think this is important to listen to and to watch in light of the claim that she departed the earth in 1990. So what does it mean to say that this clearly living member of the human family had departed this earth in 1990. I suggest that what this does explicitly is invoke a kind of Manichaean dualism, which makes a distinction between our bodies and our real selves, right? And this plays out in various ways, but you might be familiar with the kind of analogy of the ghost in the machine or something like that, that we're really not our bodies, we're the ghost in a machine. And this is a really, really important point for what I'm making throughout today's presentation and in my book, that this is a fundamental mistake, that we are essentially our bodies, that we are, to use a fancy phrase, hylomorphic creatures. We're a mixture of body and soul. And without one or the other, you miss something essential about what it is to be us. But I want to argue that the groundwork for making the judgment that someone like Terry in 22 had departed this earth was laid well before that. This is Roger Ebert. He got his MD from the University of Chicago in 1942, and who is dean of Harvard Medical School from 65 to 77. Ebert had a problem, though, soon after he became dean, and his name was Henry K. Beecher. Beecher was a very famous and still remains a very famous anesthesiologist, and he was also the chairman of Harvard Medical School's IRB. He kept pushing his dean to change the definition of death. Why? Because, quote, every major hospital has patients stacked up waiting for suitable donors. Beecher succeeded in petitioning Ebert to establish what would become the famous, at least in my world, famous 1968 ad hoc committee of the Harvard Medical School to examine the definition of brain death, and he succeeded in getting the outcome he wanted, but only after a failed first draft of the committee's report. And Ebert's response to Beecher's first draft was, quote, it suggests that you wish to define death in order to make viable organs more readily available to persons requiring transplants. That is true, because that's exactly what the first draft of the article of the report made explicit. It was still explicit, I think, in the revised version, but they at least tried to make it seem like it was about something else as well. So what happened here is very interesting. The shift from a cardiopulmonary definition of death to a so-called brain death standard happened not because it was motivated by, you know, really good arguments or new biological evidence or something like that. It was because we needed a different definition in order to get viable organs. Now, this takes place, of course, because of the advent not only of the technology to be able to transplant vital organs, but also because of the technology of the ventilator being newly around and able to save patients with catastrophic brain injuries that otherwise wouldn't have been able to be saved. Despite this, despite these, I would say, dubious origins, though I myself am an organ donor, I think it's a very laudable thing to do. This view of the human person has become the law in all 50 states of the union, with only New York and New Jersey allowing for religious freedom exemptions. Though these exemptions would become very, very important, especially for this story I'd like us to focus on a little bit as well. More current story. Perhaps you've heard of the story of Jahi McMath. I just want to play a little clip that will tell you that story in more detail.
Months after several neurologists declared her brain dead, a Bay Area family wants that ruling reversed.
KPIX5's Linda Yee shows us the video that Jahi McMath's family says is proof that she is alive. Linda?
Well, Ken, the video clips do show movement, but are they what some neurologists say are spontaneous reflexes common in brain dead patients, or is it truly a miracle?
Come on, girl, we're watching. Come on, girl, you did that. Very good.
She moved her foot on command, says Jahi's mother, and as the days passed, there was more.
Very good.
Very good,
Jahi. Nyla Wingfield has been by her daughter's bedside for the past 9 months.
So then I said, okay, well, move your thumb if you can hear me. And then she moves her thumb again, so I said, okay. So she knows the difference between left and right. She knows her fingers. if I say move your leg, she can, that's something that she could do with no issues.
The family's attorney showed brain scans and EEG results. To bolster their argument, the neurosurgeons at Oakland's Children's Hospital were wrong when they said Jahai was brain dead. And a panel of whom they describe as experts with the International Brain Research Foundation spoke of the findings by phone.
And now we know that at least parts of the brain are functioning.
So we think, this young lady also has the potential to gain more function. No guarantees, of course.
His colleague, neuroscientist Philip DeFina, insists more could be done to help Jahai.
Obviously, we're dealing with someone that's alive.
Questions have been raised about DeFina's doctorate in clinical psychology. It's from an online university, and he was fired by a New Jersey hospital over a controversial therapy for autistic children. But Jahai's mother believes their findings and hopes it will bring her daughter back from the New Jersey facility that has cared for her since January.
I'd like to see her back in California.
The reason why she was not in California was because the state of California had declared her dead already, and that New Jersey, as I mentioned before, was one of only two states that allow the kind of religious freedom that her family took advantage of to continue to care for Jahai. We already know, even before Jahai's case, that people who are described as brain dead can fight off infections, respond to and heal bodily trauma, reach puberty. Jahai, in fact, got her first period after she already had a death certificate from the state of California. And perhaps you've even heard of these cases of so-called brain dead individuals who are pregnant gestating children to birth successfully. But I think it's worth pointing out, especially given the role contemporary secularized medicine plays in all of this, that the medical team played in all of this. This is Dr. David Durand, PEDS chief at UC San Francisco, where Jahai was staying and her family was staying. What is it you don't understand? Dr. Durand condescendingly asked them. Then, according to Jahai's mother, stepfather, grandmother, brother, and their lawyer who took notes, Durand pounded his fist on the table saying, "She's dead, dead, dead." This is an absolutely key shift, how we thought about brain death, all the way from the Harvard Brain Death Commission to Jahai and beyond. And I think Peter Singer, a philosopher on whom I've written a lot, including the whole book, is right about this shift. He also thinks it's a transformative shift. In fact, he calls it a Copernican revolution against fundamental human equality. He doesn't mind the fact, he's happy, in fact, that there's been a revolution against fundamental human equality. Because the idea that human beings bearing the common nature that reflects the image and likeness of God has been abandoned in favor of an ethic along the lines of Singer's, that's a good thing for him. And it's interesting to note that Peter Singer, in his book, Practical Ethics, struggles to come up with any basis for equality at all. But he calls this a Copernican revolution, and I fundamentally agree. We went from having the center of our thinking about human and personal morality being the human being to a very different kind of center, again, focused on autonomy, rationality, self-awareness, productivity, will, and the like. Interestingly enough, even though we have this supposed consensus on this, and the consensus was so strong that the head of PEDS at Jahai's hospital banged his fist on the table saying she's dead, 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 there appears to be, anyway, a very, very important article from the Journal of Neurological Sciences, peer-reviewed journal, saying that Jahai McMath was actually not brain dead upon further review. In fact, you can see here they describe it as something called responsive unawake syndrome. They come up with a kind of neologism to describe what she was. Now, we can have debates about, whether she was brain dead or not, or, what criteria we should use for determining that sort of thing. But one thing I think we can't argue with is that lots of people who, even by those that want to hold on to brain death as a thing, lots of people are declaring brain dead who are being declared brain dead who are in fact not brain dead, whatever term we use for it, responsive unawake syndrome or something else. So that's the shift, it seems to me, that took place. We started declaring people, quote unquote, brain dead, and use that as a definition of death when it was wholly inappropriate. And that has pushed us on a path which is deeply, deeply troubling. And we've already looked at PVS, or so-called persistent vegetative state, when it comes to Terry Schiavo, but let's dive a little deeper into that. If you're interested in these questions and you haven't yet read Joe Finn's book, Rights Come to Mind, I very, very much recommend it. It is a magisterial text. And Joe Finns, if you know anything about him, he's a physician and prominent bioethicist as well. And he has done a 180 on this based on his own research on this. He's by no means a kind of, conservative or pro-life or, Christian thinker or person at all. But he is open-minded and he is willing to follow the evidence and the research. After Finns, I think we're without excuse when it comes to thinking about PVS. He says, even though the vegetative state has become something of a catechism in North American bioethics, I think that's a very evocative word, catechism, to describe it. I think that's right in a secular sense. But he speaks dramatically and movingly about this population and the need for their basic civil rights. What he's found through his research in this book and even beyond now is that we can now coax people who are in a so-called PVS back to explicit consciousness with the right therapies. So in fact, there was a story he tells from his research about a neurologist who happened to see that his patient seemed to be blinking in a way that was systematic and trying to communicate. And this neurologist happily decided to try some innovative therapies and was able to coax that individual back to a kind of consciousness, or at least maybe it's more precise to say coax them to a place where we could recognize their consciousness. There were also interesting studies done well before this book, Finn's book, which show that if you do an fMRI on the brain of folks who are just kind of put into this persistent vegetative state label or permanent vegetative state label and ask them questions, yes or no questions. And you say, hey, if the answer is yes, imagine you're playing tennis. If the answer is no, imagine you're reading in your room. That by reading the fMRI machine and which part of the brain lit up, they were able to answer yes or no questions correctly 30% of the time. So 30% of the time it didn't light up at all, but 30% of the time when it lit up, they were able to answer yes or no questions correctly. So why hasn't, I think it's worth asking, that book was in 2015. Why hasn't Finn's call for the civil rights movement for so-called PVS patients been heeded? He calls it prognostic pessimism and therapeutic nihilism. And he says that on the one hand, the commitment to healthcare resources is considered too large. That's a commitment that's a concern throughout my book. That actually it's resource questions that often drive who is in and who is out when it comes to who counts as us, who is equal to us. Again, with brain death, it was the allocation of organs, that issue of resources. Here, I think there is a question of resources as well. But I think this is equally important. The rejection of the perceived fixity of so-called PVS could, quote, undermine the hard-won right to die, including the iconic case of Terry Schiavo, which was really important for that, according to him. Indeed, and Joe Finns is by no means a pro-lifer. If anything, he has antipathy for pro-lifers. He says, quote, without the futility of the permanent vegetative state of permanent unconsciousness, are we obliged to promote a culture of life? End quote. I think there's also an implicit threat to abortion rights, which is where I also want to go in my talk today. It's worth noting that especially now with Dobbs on the way this year, probably be decided this June or July. We're talking a lot about Supreme Court jurisprudence, but we're talking a lot about Roe versus Wade. And I don't quite understand why, because Planned Parenthood versus Casey is still actually the governing framework for abortion in the United States. The framework in Casey replaced the framework in Roe, even though it uphold the central holding in Roe. The framework is now Casey's. It is no longer Roe's. And I think in light of what we've been saying so far, it's really, really interesting and important and frankly disturbing to think about the plurality opinion, which came from O'Connor, Souter, and Kennedy as they replaced the privacy centered standard in Roe with something called the undue burden standard. And with remarkable candor, they also invoke economic reasons, allocation of resources as a major factor in keeping abortion legal. This quote is worth reading. For two decades of economic and social developments, people have organized intimate relationships and made choices that define their views of themselves and their places in society in reliance on the availability of abortion in the event that contraception should fail, the ability of women to participate equally in the economic and social life of the nation has been facilitated by their ability to control their reproductive lives. So there's no wrestling with prenatal justice here. There's no wrestling with who counts as us. In fact, the die has already been cast by 1992. Being human is not enough. And furthermore, this issue of economic and social equality is so important that we must have a certain view of abortion and by extension of prenatal justice so that the economic and social life can be equal. Now, I'm a pro-life feminist, and I think there are deep questions to ask about whether this is even correct, but it's yet another example of economics playing a serious role here. A few years ago, a really infamous case, that of Ehrlich Klofner, came into view. He was the one that had, he was an abortion doctor, right? He kept thousands of bodies and body parts of prenatal children in his garage and in the trunk of his car. And local media started digging around after this, obviously, is a big story. Local CBS 2019 Chicago story went into it in some detail. And that's bad enough, right, that he did these things. But he actually, I think it's worth noting in light of the economic concerns just raised, that we focus on this part of the story, but from, a 2019 CBS Chicago story. There was this woman who he had treated, quote unquote, and she was interviewed, and she said she thought to myself, oh, my God, I did this awful thing, and my children are possibly kept in a box somewhere in a house. I cried. I said to myself at the time, she's now saying, I can't bring kids into the situation. I can't bring kids into poverty. I can't bring my kids to a father who won't love them or won't want them. And she was actually hesitating to have an abortion of her twins at the time. Klofner's response, if you don't do this, it will cost you yearly $240,000 to take care of a kid. Almost certainly that's not right, but nevertheless. So would you rather deal with that or would you rather go home and just go back to your regular life? There was no emotion. There was no empathy, according to her and according to this story. So this is a very dramatic example, but this is not unusual, right? This idea that we need to keep prenatal children marginalized, keep prenatal children not our equals because of our concern about allocation of scarce resources. So let's kind of pause here for a moment and think about a confluence of several interrelated factors that have put us on this current trajectory that we've already talked about, kind of gather ourselves here. So one, the secularization of medicine and the rise and dominance of irreligious bioethics, a Copernican revolution against fundamental human equality, pressure on medical and other resources, and then interlocking and mutually reinforcing and dependent views about moral status in relation to brain death, PVS, abortion, and more. So if that's our current trajectory, where are we going from here? I think it's important to ask. And where we're going from here, can be described as, I think we're going to dementia and especially later stage dementia as an important factor here. Maybe you saw over the course of the pandemic, and I've just put two headlines here, one from Politico and one from the AP, on how not from COVID, but how there's been a wave of dementia deaths, which have added thousands to the pandemic's that deadly toll. Again, as the AP headline says, not just COVID, the kind of neglect which has taken place for those suffering from dementia in care homes over the last year and a half has been extraordinary and worthy of note. I think it's also the fact that the pandemic revealed something that was already going on, that we already had an embarrassing lack of care for this population, the one that didn't respect their fundamental equality. And here I want to return actually to Peter Singer and tell a very quick story about his mother, Cora Singer. Peter Singer, was pressed actually on his views on rejecting fundamental human equality. And he famously says, you know, it's not only, you know, Terri Schiavo and Jahi McMath are not persons, but even those who have late stage dementia are no longer persons because they're not rational, self-aware, et cetera. And he was pushed on this and said, an interviewer asked him, hey, guess what? Your mom, Cora Singer, had late stage dementia. Did you spend resources on her? Because Peter Singer had said, because of limited resources, again, focus on limited resources, we ought not to spend healthcare resources on those non-persons, human non-persons. We should only spend our limited healthcare resources on actual persons. He calls them biographically alive, not just biologically alive. But his own mother had ceased to become biographically alive, according to his definition. And he had put his own resources into her care in a way that violated his own principle. And he had said, well, it's super hard when it's your mom, but I really think the principle actually stands. And I think this is a really important case to point to. He did not abandon the principle. He just said it was really hard to talk about. But that's what happens when you follow the principle consistently. When you abandon fundamental human equality and instead focus on these traits, you end up, if you apply your view consistently, to those who have lost their rationality and self-awareness in later stages of dementia. And here, I think it's really important actually to focus on an interviewee from Rights Come to Mind. Again, this is Joe Finn's book, which mentioned that in their parents' nursing home, they had a floor where the staff, quote, just put everyone who had no opportunity or no prospect of being very alive, Alzheimer's patients, people who were in PVS. So they had this horrible second floor. If you went up there, it was filthy. The staff was bad. So if we're thinking especially about what I mentioned yesterday, last night, and throwaway culture, there's a floor that this person is describing where they kind of just throw away or discard folks that this interviewee says had no prospect of ever being very alive. It's interesting that he actually doesn't have a good way of really precisely describing it, because that inability to describe it precisely, I think, names or at least points to a big argument of what I'm trying to make here today and in my book. The fact that he's not able to name that, I think, points to this tension we now have in the culture. Are we going to move in along the current trajectory and just say individuals who have lost their rationality and self-awareness are no longer persons, just like so-called PVS individuals are no longer persons, just like so-called brain dead individuals are no longer persons? Or are we going to try to move things in a different direction? Here's what's at stake, I think, in trying to talk about this. I hope you don't think it's too dramatic, but I just want to play a little bit from my book's trailer as a way of highlighting what I think is at stake here.
I know, it's the last thing you want to think about, but consider the COVID-19 pandemic with me for a moment. I'd invite you to think not about the virus, but about what it has exposed. There's something going on and it needs to be sorted out. That's a quote from Robert Anderson, Chief of Mortality Statistics at the CDC. Our unspoken horror story in this country is how we treat people in nursing homes, especially those suffering from dementia. Worldwide, more than 50 million people are living with dementia. And that number will double every 20 years. nurses are abandoning the profession, leaving nursing homes understaffed. People can make better money at Walmart than they can by caring for our most vulnerable. This is on track to get worse and spiral into a crisis. A crisis that touches everyone and damages everything. Society can therefore choose one of three paths. First, we can slouch towards robot care, which isn't real care because it isn't human. Second, we could slide into euthanasia, solving a social problem by killing those who need care. The third option is to move with urgency to restore human dignity.
I really don't see, and I'll be interested in the Q&A if you can come up with different options. These are the only three I think we have left, unless we keep the status quo.
Challenging path.
I think it's worth noting that the current trajectory is unsustainable. So we could go to those three different options, but the current trajectory is really bad. I mean, here is already these three headlines. Here are already deep, profound examples of moving towards death, aiming at death as a way of trying to solve these problems. But if we're going to think about what we're currently doing, I really worry that these will seem like better options if it really gets out what we're actually doing, what we're currently doing. The New York Times did a expose on what's happening with at nursing homes for residents who have later stage dementia. It looks like from their analyses, and there was already some evidence to support this, but this just kind of firmed it up, that doctors working for these nursing homes regularly write scripts for antipsychotic drugs for residents who don't need them. Schizophrenia diagnoses are up dramatically, while delusions and hallucinations are down. The federal agency that was quoted in the story said 1/3 of long-term nursing home patients diagnosed with schizophrenia had no record of being treated for the condition. They want docile. They want to give these folks antipsychotic drugs to keep them docile, but these drugs actually double the chances of death. And just to bring it back to the connection to resources, I do think this is evil, but this is coming out of a desperate place in some ways for these homes, these care homes, in part because they don't have the resources and staffing to treat their residents as equal to the rest of us. Now, how to respond to all of this? And this is where I'll finish and look forward to your questions. Let me just say, I think the main thing to do is to raise the alarm about this trajectory, to encourage us to speak out clearly and forcefully about this, and to not be bashful and hiding behind especially where our culture says those of us with an explicitly theological view belong. I mean, I would argue that a theological point of view is absolutely necessary to respond to this. We have to say human beings are equal because they share a common human nature that's made in the image and likeness of God. And we should not be embarrassed of that principle, especially in light of what's at stake here. I would say that maybe we can do this with a little more confidence than with some of the other issues when it comes to dementia, because dementia has not yet, at least in my estimation, been politicized the way abortion, PVS, and brain death have been, especially given our allies at the disability rights communities. There's really important work here to be done that could be a bridge for dialogue, saying, hey, are you okay with us essentially putting people with dementia in warehouses of death and giving them antipsychotic drugs they don't need and treat them as less than human? And where do you think this is going to go if we don't step in now and move to treat this population with fundamental human equality? I think I'd be interested to know again in the Q&A what you think about this. I think this is an issue that could transcend the left-right divide. It could be a purple or magenta issue. In fact, it's not a red state, blue state divide, it seems to me. And in the book, I finished by talking about three sets of steps to take. One would be a kind of short term, another would be a medium term, another would be a long term set of steps. I mean, immediately we can all respond to the dementia care crisis by doing things as individuals, families, and communities and churches, right? We can reorient ourselves to take care of these populations in a different way. We talked about some of them last night when we talked about resisting throwaway culture. You know, can we build a culture of encounter between generations, between younger people and older people? Can we take care of our families and stay around for our families and welcome them into our homes, for instance? Can our communities and churches reorient themselves to take care of these groups? I've actually thought, I don't know what it's like in Louisiana, but up here in the Northeast, there are a lot of empty convents and schools from convents and schools closing that the church owns and kind of either does nothing with or rents out. Could we reorient these physical plants to take care of the elderly with, again, a culture of encounter in mind, an antidote to throwaway culture that would respect them as fundamentally equal to us, rather than, again, warehousing them in places that are simply going to medicate them until they die. And then that would be kind of like what we can do now, actually, if we want. And then maybe a third or a second set of steps that I might call medium term is to, again, build dialogue. We really need to have a seat at the table. That's why I love this this bioethics series that you're doing and the commitment you have to show how faith really matters to the practice of medicine and to clinical practitioners in particular. We need to be able to build dialogue, especially within the medical communities and healthcare communities, so that we can advocate for this view of fundamental human equality and push back against this trajectory. And again, we have allies here. We have disability rights groups. We also have other religious groups. So again, the New York and New Jersey exceptions that we have for brain death didn't come from Christians mostly. Mostly it came from Orthodox Jews in this area who wanted to take care of their brain dead loved ones. And they organized and got together and were able to carve out this religious exemption in New York and New Jersey. I've been talking with some of them here in New Jersey, actually, and building dialogue and praising the Orthodox Jews in my area for saying, you've been way ahead of us on this issue. Congratulations. Now, how can we work together to try to move this in a different direction? And then finally, and I'll finish with this, what if we fail? What if this doesn't work out? What if the dialogue doesn't work and we continue on this trajectory where, again, this population is going to double every 20 years? I think we need to be prepared for this. I think if I had to bet, I would bet, actually, that the dialogue will fail. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't try as best as we possibly can. I just don't think it looks very good. It may be for the time for the church to be the church at this point and respond as we have responded historically to other emergencies, including medical emergencies. There's some evidence actually from historians who are scholars of the early church to say that it was actually how the early church responded to medical emergencies like pandemics that helped grow the church from a kind of marginal group that was associated with Judaism to being its kind of own thing that grew into something that would later become very, very popular within ancient Greece and Rome. And we can get into some of the evidence if you want for this, but there are a number of historians who say this took place in part because of how the church responded to medical emergencies, especially compared to the surrounding culture. And we may well find ourselves in this context again. If we already can't care for the millions and millions and millions of people with later stage dementia in this country, can you imagine it doubling over the next 20 years? What is that going to look like? It may be the church, and perhaps other religious groups will be the only ones left to care for this, to care for this population. And we might need a kind of all hands on deck approach. And I get into some of that in the book. We might need new religious orders. We might need whole, you know, it could be a really dramatic thing, but let me finish by saying it could also be a really, really important source of energy for the church as well. And even perhaps evangelization, maybe just as with the early church, our commitment to seeing the face of Christ in these vulnerable populations that virtually no one else wanted to care for could be similarly like salt and light for the culture as it was in the ancient world. So I'll just leave that there and see if you have any questions. I hope you do.
Okay, thank you for that intriguing and insightful presentation, Dr. Kamosi. As you were speaking, I couldn't help but think of, we have a director of gerontology here at the university who is an intelligent, faithful woman, and I bet she would be fired up to hear what you're talking about and would get some good ideas going for our own local community. So really insightful, thanks for that. We've already got some Q&A questions rolling in. I just want to remind everyone that the link to the Q&A or the icon is at the bottom of your screen. I also want to mention, as I did at the beginning, that we have a just really quick survey to fill out. It takes about 2 minutes, so I'll put that in the chat. And that helps us collect some data that will help our REACH program for integrating ethics into our formation of our students. And then a last note of business I just want to add in here is, if any of our attendees would like to join the listserv for the bioethics lecture series, I will put a quick link just for a form where all you have to do is give us your name and email. And that listserv will notify you of our future lectures. And Dr. Kamosi actually mentioned last night, Dr. Kristen Collier from the University of Michigan. She's actually going to be our lecturer next semester. And she specializes in the integration of spirituality and medicine. So we're really excited to have her. So if you join the listserv, we'll notify you when that lecture is coming up. And we'll also release the videos. We're recording these lectures with Dr. Kamosi, and we'll put some links to videos up there in case you wanted to watch them again or share them with other people. So I'll also put that in the chat. Okay, now let's go to the Q&A. And Charlie, I'm gonna use host privileges to just ask the first question myself.
Please do.
I was thinking about our own university and other places that do the education of health professionals. And as an analogy, sometimes if you're at a Catholic school, if you're a religion teacher at a Catholic school, it's easy to lament that some of these important things, especially an understanding of dignity, seems to be given only to the religion department to, you know, inculcate that in the students. But it seems to me that this is the sort of thing that you are mentioning here takes a whole cultural shift. And I'm wondering, even for our own university, have you seen any good ways in which other people are being able to form their students, not just in terms of theology classes or ethics classes and philosophy, but ways in which it's been incorporated into medical education? And would you have any resources that you could recommend for it?
Now, I'm one person, obviously, but I don't have a lot to report, unfortunately, on this. I don't have, as you were talking, I was realizing what you were asking. I was becoming increasingly nervous because I'm like, okay, what, how am I going to answer this? Because I'm kind of doing the Rolodex in my mind. And I'm like, well, there are some good centers, right? And there are good individuals and there are good books. But I really can't frankly think of a good model to use, given your important insight, which is this is not just for a theology department. This is not just for a nursing department. This is not just for a medical school. This is not just for, it's got to come from the community. It's got to come from the fundamental values that shape the particular community. Now, as the presentation makes clear, I worry about what values are in fact shaping that. And even among many self-identified Catholic communities, you might want to see more of the kinds of values I was trying to highlight here at play. But when you have different departments, when you have different concerns, when you have different values, when you're hiring for mission means, who knows what hiring for mission means, right? It could be any number of things that at least in my experience could fall into that. It's really hard to get everyone on the same page when it comes to this, especially when the politics of so many of these issues kind of permeates and creates barriers, frankly, to having honest and open conversations along the lines we talked about last night. So I really do think it comes from the community itself, though, deciding like what exactly are our driving sets of principles and what is our identity and how will that be reflected throughout. When you think about especially the contemporary university, though, and you think about academic freedom, you think about giving departments their own autonomy and ability to make decisions along these lines, it just becomes really hard to think about how that might work, however. Maybe the structures themselves, I hope this isn't a cop-out, maybe the structures themselves need to be changed in a way to allow these principles and ideas to more effectively permeate throughout our communities and institutions. But I'm not sure how to do that without in some ways fundamentally rethinking what, we imagine, the university to be today.
Yeah. Well, here's to hoping that a small Catholic university like our own, where hopefully the hurdles are fewer, can
that's right. Maybe
come
that's
together
it.
And do something, provide an example in a way that's also not just palatable for Catholics and other Christians, but to others as well. So thanks for the challenge.
Yeah, and let's do it. Let's do it.
All right. Our first question from the attendees comes from Deacon Mark Berard. And he's worried that perhaps you dismissed robots too quickly in the caring of dementia patients. He said he'd like to hear more of your thoughts on that.
Yeah, so I'm all for robots doing surgeries and technical things that when they can do better than human beings do. But as you no doubt teach your students who are doing on their way to doing clinical work, and healthcare work, hopefully we're not creating nurses and nurse practitioners and doctors and others who are just mere technicians, right? Who are just about trying to understand best how hose A fits into slot B or how to become the best organic plumber or carpenter they can be, but how to actually care for persons, right? In the Jesuit tradition, we call this cura personalis, care for the whole person. And that is something that robots by definition cannot do. And to the extent that we then say, well, for certain groups of people, their caregivers will be robots. That seems to send exactly the wrong message for what I'm arguing for in today's lecture and in my book. We need, if these folks are our equals, they should be just as likely to get a robot caregiver as you and I would get a robot caregiver or something like that, right? Which I hope is almost never, but you might be able to say, well, in light of resource allocation, that a robot is better than nothing. But I think... first, it needs to be equally distributed without a bias against folks who are suffering from late-stage dementia. And then we should really also try to allocate resources in such a way that we don't need so-called robot care. I mean, it's not just this issue. I've seen, maybe we've all seen some of these like robots that you can now are being marketed to parents for their children. Like, have you seen these commercials where like the parents look in at the kid doing their homework and interacting with the robot, you know, and they kind of like look at each other and smile and go back to whatever it is that we're doing, probably looking at their smartphone, right? So like, it's not just the slouch towards robots is not just present in this set of issues, though I think who we decide gets robots really will tell us kind of like where our priorities are.
Yeah, the philosopher Robert Sokolowski at CUA, he's a good phenomenologist, actually has a chapter of a book where he talks about the medical act as a human transaction, which I think really captures well the necessity of the humanity of both the doctor and the patient. So I thought of that as you were speaking. And I may or may not have a robot for my kids, but at least not the kind that you're speaking of. let's see. Our next question comes from Deacon Glenn Email. We're getting the deacons on board here. He wants to know, the issues you're bringing up, are they a U.S. issue or is this a worldwide issue? And if it is happening in other countries, are other countries doing any better or differently?
Well, it's interesting you brought up the international context, because it's the distinction is not really between the U.S. and the rest of the world. The distinction is between rich individualistic centered countries and those that are more community oriented and often who have less resources. So maybe you've had this experience. I certainly have in this part of the country where I talk with a recent immigrant to this country about how we treat our elderly and those suffering from dementia. And they look at you like you have two heads and can't believe that this is what you do to your elders, right? You don't keep them in your home, you put them away and you don't really ever see them, and they're desperately lonely and they die of sometimes of loneliness or related to isolation. I mean, what is going on here? In part because the communities they come from have a very different understanding of how to take care of their elders and how to honor their father and mother, and how a community actually comes together again, as I suggested, as the kind of first set of things we can do. The community comes together to care for them in a particular way. But in the book, I go into some detail actually about how dementia is playing out in one country that has had euthanasia for some time, the Netherlands. There was this case which was recently resolved of a woman who had early stage dementia. She requested physician assisted suicide, but not yet. She was saying, I need it later, you know, when my dementia is more developed. And then over time her dementia did progress, but she changed her mind and she said, I don't want this anymore. In fact, she said three times to both her family and her doctor that she didn't want this anymore. They put a drug in her coffee to sedate her, and they killed her anyway. And the doctor who killed her was put up on charges and found not guilty of anything. I think that just happened last year. So we are already slouching towards physician-assisted suicide for those with dementia, at least in the Netherlands. There's talk of it elsewhere, even California, which relatively recently legalized physician-assisted suicide. There's already a movement there to legalize it for folks who are diagnosed with early stage dementia. So we're already slouching towards this in a particular kind of way. But I think if the implication of the question is, are there other cultures who are doing this better than we are? Yes, absolutely. And it's not necessarily those who are richer. It's those that have a culture that is willing to kind of rally around our elderly as worthy of fundamental equality, maybe even in a certain sense, of a kind of respect that even goes beyond what younger people have, because their elders are so worthy of honor.
Yeah, thank you for that. The next question comes from Dr. David Whitten. In a similar vein, are there any healthcare systems or hospitals or nursing homes that you know of who are approaching these populations in a more dignified manner? And if so, how do they manage this in the face of the economic pressures that you've mentioned?
Yeah, that's a good question. And I, even though professors are good at trying to answer questions we don't know the answer to, I'm just going to pause here and say that I haven't done my research on this. So I don't know, or it's probably better to say that I have done research on this and haven't come across major differences that that you might expect at Catholic institutions versus other kinds of institutions. Now, that's not to say there that, you know, my anecdotal experiences are, you know, mean much of anything, because we would need, you know, we need to do a much more systematic exploration of this issue. But at least in theory, the answer is yes. So, I mean, I guess there is something to say. As part of my research, I did learn that Catholic Charities nursing homes, for instance, really take seriously their commitment to the elderly and to the elderly disabled in ways that, in fact, when I wrote an op-ed in the New York Times in the heart of the first part of the pandemic, when all this was really happening, the first summer of the pandemic, I got an angry email from one of the people at Catholic Charities saying, you know, why didn't you mention us? Why didn't you say all the good things we're doing? You know, this is not, you can't put all nursing homes into a particular category. But that's just one person's angry email. He and I actually became friends. Now we send emails to each other when stories come across our radar on these things. But at least there with Catholic Charities, there was a kind of mission-centered indignation about being lumped in with everyone else, right? That, yes, this is a problem, but we're really trying to do this a different way. What I don't see, frankly, and here's, this is an overly long answer. What I don't see, frankly, and I wish we did see more, is Catholic institutions and mission-driven institutions focus on taking care of loved ones at home, trying our best to create resources and offer resources to families who would prefer to do this. It's cheaper to do. It's what both the caregiver and the person in need of care prefer most of the time. And yet we are kind of pushed into these other ways of doing this. And I think this is one thing parishes might be able to mobilize and try to work on. Can parishes or dioceses work to create institutions, committees, groups of volunteers, to make sure that if a family wants to take care of their loved one at home, that they will be able to have the resources they need to be able to do that? I think that would be a lovely culture of encounter building thing for the church to do to respond.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And it shows the systemic nature of the problem too, because at least here we have a two-income society. So being able to take care of mom or dad when they're getting older and more ill is an economic burden for a lot of people, even for those who would want to.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Just anecdotally, by the way, since we were speaking of nursing homes, I have been to Little Sisters of the Poor in Pittsburgh and in Queens. And I will say those had to be two of the most joy-filled nursing homes that I've ever been to. So I wonder if the sisters have some sort of secret to share with us.
I should have mentioned them. That's an embarrassing thing I didn't mention them, in part because for the launch of the book, we had one of the little sisters as part of our webinar, which launched the book. So yes, that's a good call. And I should have mentioned them as well.
Yeah. A follow-up question from Dr. Whitten. He's wondering, is it possible that the secular training of doctors is a real obstacle for organizations making progress in this area, even those, you know, organizations that want to make progress?
I think it is. It is because, and I go into this in some detail in the book, the kinds of training that goes into secularized medical context really does, it's not neutral. It comes with a particular understanding of the good. And often the idea that your life has value if you're severely mentally compromised or have a massive brain injury or disease, it sort of goes with the kind of like implicit understanding that you would not want to live that way. One would not want to live that way. And so if we're not inculcating healthcare providers with this idea that life is intrinsically valuable and equally valuable regardless of those matters, then yes, I think that's absolutely right.
All right. The next question comes from Christian Haynes. Christian asks, can efforts be made for more of a push toward charitable works in society? As early as elementary school, children can learn to give, care, and be aware. I feel this is the best way to curtail these issues and other issues of a throwaway culture. So an early sort of formation.
I think so. And I think Catholic education could maybe lead the way here. At the end of my presentation yesterday, I was suggesting that perhaps we could really move to have intergenerational encounters. So we could talk about, for instance, really lonely young people being connected with really lonely older people, and what, you know, what kind of institutions could bear this sort of thing. Actually, I forgot to mention this last night. I was going to talk about it. My own parish has a convent that maybe has two sisters left in it. They're both retired. It's not clear how much longer they'll be in that facility. And I asked my pastor, I said, you know, could, when this is available, could we turn this into, you know, a care home that would build a culture of encounter with it. And we have a school that isn't ours, but it's rented out to, leased out to a group doing care for special needs children. And then I thought, you know, because I'm an ivory tower professor who thinks unrealistically about big things, I thought, can't we have a, you know, a kind of mutuality, a kind of intergenerational mutuality between a care home that we would, again, build in a certain way, have the structure itself built a certain way to maximize encounters, but also have a kind of, you know, intrinsically understood connection between the school and the care home. And that was just kind of thinking out loud about, you know, how our particular parish might do this. But what if Catholic education and elementary education and middle school and even older education also built that kind of expectation, and that we would try to inculcate these values in our young people, not just for when they're older, but, you know, to actually serve both needs again. I mean, last night we talked about just how desperately lonely young people are, especially as their addiction to social media and their smartphones kick in. This, it seems to me, would be, you know, just like almost a no-brainer from the amount of good it would provide, both just straight up for the kids and the older folks themselves, but also for thinking about, you know, how do we build cultures of encounter more broadly?
Mm. That's an awesome idea. I think the more intergenerational encounter can be, the better. And sometimes in the church, we're good at siloing, you know, the youth do the youth thing, families do the family thing, young adults do the young adult thing, but that's what a brilliant idea. If we could bring Catholic schools together with care homes for elders, spectacular. And it also strikes me that this culture of encounter will have to be even present in the administration and with their employees, because it, you know, it was striking that you mentioned the wage of people who work in nursing homes being deficient. I mean, that's not going to get the best of care. You're going to get high turnover and things like that.
It's hard, then it's hard to attract good, dedicated people as well. Yeah, that's really important point. And the church itself needs to imagine itself as being a sign of opposition, I think, when it comes to these things. But we have to decide that it's a priority for us, you know, and hopefully we can do that.
Yeah. The next question comes from Ms. Haley Mason. And she asked, when someone is told by a medical professional that there's nothing left to do to save a loved one, how do we know when it's time for us to pull the plug, so to speak? How do we know when it's actually us as family members being selfish by exhausting efforts to keep them alive, or when it's time for us to let them go?
Yeah, that's an important distinction to make between, you know, to make a distinction between the point I was making in the presentation in this book and the church's tradition on the difference between ordinary means of treatment and extraordinary means of treatment. So, and those are held in really important balance with each other. So I want to stand firm behind everything I said in my presentation. Like, I don't think any of the populations we talked about are non-persons, human non-persons. They matter just as much as the rest of us. But just as the rest of us could, either through our own will or through that of a surrogate, say there's certain treatment, even life-saving treatment, life-sustaining treatment that's extraordinary and can be forgone, licitly be forgone, where one is not aiming at one's death, but rather foregoing treatment that is extraordinary or disproportionate, then that's a very different thing from saying, okay, it is time for you to die now, right? This is where we aim at death. And instead of accompanying people, instead of showing compassion, suffering with people, we aim at their death and say, it is time for you to die now. And that's a kind of violence, that's killing. The definition of euthanasia in a Catholic context is an act or an omission which of itself or by intention causes death. So whether you're actually injecting someone with pain medication or just giving them antipsychotic drugs and just leaving them die because it's time for them to die and you don't want to take care of them, there's no distinction. That's both kind of aiming at death, or at least it could be if that's the intention in both cases. But there are times where we just say enough is enough. Interventions are disproportionate without any outcome. I mean, to do everything to save your life or the life of somebody else is just not, that's a kind of idolatry as well, or at least it can be. The example of Christ hanging on the cross is an example, I think, of somebody who didn't do everything he could to save his own life. The early martyrs, of course, and martyrs in general are examples of folks who often didn't do everything to save their own lives. They didn't aim at their death either. That's super important. But we live in we have a moral, theological, and bioethics vision, which makes an important distinction between the two. Never aim at death. Acknowledge there are times to refuse or forego life-sustaining treatment, and for sure never say, this person is just a corpse, just a vegetable, just someone that's like not our equals in a certain way.
Yeah, that's a great answer, and you managed to pack a lot of good theology into a short answer too. Yeah, Haley, by the way, we also have a theological healthcare ethics class, and so if you want to know more about that, we dive in deep there about the difference between proportionate, disproportionate, ordinary, and extraordinary care. So thanks for asking that question, Haley. Charlie, we've got two more, I think. So this one comes from Mark Cloutier, who is in formation to be a deacon. And he wants to know, in your research, do you see any difference between the way secular hospitals and Catholic or faith-based hospitals work when it comes to these issues? Do you think that the teachings of the faith put up safeguards for human equality?
I think so. So not every Catholic institution, healthcare institution, follows the ethical and religious directives the same way, interprets them the same way. But those ethical and religious directives are really, really important safeguards against some of what I discussed in my presentation. Now, I think there are slippery places, though, where you could say that, well, we're not really aiming at death here. We're foregoing extraordinary treatment. And sometimes that kind of discussion can, and it sounds like you're very aware of this, Brian, you teach your students about this. God bless you for diving into these really thorny issues. You know, sometimes it's just not clear what someone's intention is. You can have even multiple intentions at the same time. And even if the intention is not to aim at death, perhaps there's a kind of dismissiveness or a kind of throwaway. That's where I really like throwaway culture as a concept for naming something. It isn't really necessarily about trying to kill, but about trying to like rid oneself of a problem, or to kind of dismiss it or discard it in ways you don't have to really think about it too much. I think that's actually what's going on with a lot of our populations that have dementia now. We kind of push them off to the side, give them way too much medication to keep them docile, and just kind of let them die. Now, is that, I guess you could be aiming at their death, but you could also just be saying, well, you know, we don't have resources. We're kind of in this weird situation. I got to work two jobs to keep food on the table for my family. I just don't have the resources. And that's more of like how our structures are set up in a throwaway culture than it is about euthanasia or something like that. So even with the ethical, I guess a long way of saying, even with the ethical and religious directives, maybe there are still questions to ask about the kinds of things I was bringing up. But at the very least, I think we need to have a hypervigilance in our Catholic institutions for this vision of human dignity, to make sure we're not, you know, following the letter of the law here, whereas we kind of still slip into this other way of throwaway culture and of marginalizing certain groups.
Okay, yeah, thank you for that. And by the way, for some of the attendees watching who might not even be familiar with the ethical and religious directives, the Bishops' Conference actually has what we call the ERDs, which can help offer some principles that can guide medical decisions and medical acts. So you can find those online. Our last question comes from Dr. Shane Owens, and he wonders, does this issue of an overly intellectualist view of personhood, or maybe an autonomous or a conscious-based view of personhood, does this also relate to the question of non-elder mentally handicapped, for instance, those with Downs or those on the autism spectrum?
Yes, it definitely does. And I spent some time in the book going beyond just intellectual disability, which seems to have totally obliterated things like rationality and self-awareness, to those folks who have either inhibited or kind of damaged in some way, or have it in different ways. I mean, we just need to look, for instance, at the abortion rate of those who are diagnosed with Down syndrome or thought to have Down syndrome in utero to understand the kind of judgments that are being made. It's somewhere between 65 and 90% of babies in the United States are killed via abortion this way. I think we already know how disability rights groups are almost constantly trying to draw our attention to our ableist suppositions about who matters and how they are treated and what kind of ways they're included or not included. I mean, this was an important factor during the pandemic, even like who would get certain kinds of resources when there were limited ventilators or limited ICU beds. States had in place protocols at the beginning of the pandemic, much to our shame, that would invoke intellectual disability as a factor for your not being prioritized for those facilities. So, I talk about a case in the book about a young child with a severe disability who was thought to be not a candidate for a life-saving transplant as a result of that. This happened actually at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, CHOP, which is one of the leading children's hospitals in the entire world. So yes, the answer is yes. It's not just the really, really profound disability where most of these intellectual capacities are destroyed, but also those where it's less profound, where this shows up for sure.
Awesome. Well, with that, I think it's a good time to end. And so I want to, again, extend our thanks to you, Charlie, for two really inspiring and thought-provoking presentations. I found them personally edifying myself. And of course, an open invitation to you to come visit anytime.
I need to come.
Down south. We'll make sure there's plenty of jambalaya ready for you. We can go scope out hotel parking lots to see what their parking designations are, whatever you like. So thanks again for joining us. And thank you, everyone, all the attendees, for joining us as well. Please remember that in the chat, there are two links, one to join the listserv and one just a 2-minute survey that'll help us collect some data for the REACH program. So thanks again, everyone. Hope you have a wonderful day. And thanks for joining us for Franciscan Week.